you, Sister Trick, Tiger Lou, Randy. Praise God. Amen. God bless you all. Welcome to the house of our God. Praise the Lord. It is the house of God, right? This is a house like no other house, right? This is the greatest house on earth. We come into this house to praise our God. Amen. Yeah, that's right. To worship him. I pray that you get lost in him. You know, I think we need that. I think you need to get lost in God. I really do. Because I think that's where you find yourself, lost in him. Amen. But it's good to see you all here today. Brother Bill, God bless you, sir. Good to see you back there, my brother. Praise God. You know, I really wanted to start today by asking you a question. And the question that I would like to ask is this. Does anybody know, according to Jesus Christ, which is the greatest commandment? Does anybody know? Is there anybody out there who's not afraid to say which one is the? That's right. Do you remember when the religious leaders, they were challenging Jesus Christ, and it was hard to compete with Jesus? And then finally, one of the lawyers, well, why don't we turn there? Let's read this account. Finally, one of the lawyers came up to him and then asked that question. Let's look to Matthew 22. And I want you to start off by discovering or rediscovering what is the greatest command according to Jesus Christ. So in Matthew 22, verse 34, let's read a few verses here. The passage tells us that, but when the Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together. Then one of them, a lawyer, how about that, huh? One of them, a lawyer. So this was not a heartfelt question. I think they were trying to trap him again. But it was a lawyer that asked him a question and testing him. How dare you? I mean, come on, my goodness. They were testing Jesus Christ, testing him, saying, "Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law?" And as you have just said earlier, Jesus said to him, you want to read that with me? "You shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. And this is the first and great commandment. And of course, the second is like it. You shall love who? You shall love your neighbor as yourself. And on these two commandments hang the law and the prophets." Praise God, everybody. The word of the Lord. Which is the greatest commandment according to Jesus? The greatest commandment is love. To love God and to love your neighbor. I find that to be interesting, and I'll tell you why in a second. You know, if you look in your bulletins today and you see the title of our conversation, in your bulletins, the title of our conversation is written, "The Glory of the Lord." However, I would like to rename the title and our conversation today, and I'd like to call the title of our conversation today, rather, "The Law of the Human Heart." And I want you to remember that, the law of the human heart. I find this topic to be personal for myself, and I hope you find it to be personal for you. I love how God always sheds light within our darkness, and he shows us a side of ourselves that we never knew. But it was how he created us, amen. But let me read to you what the law of the human heart is, and I think you can agree with this. The law of the human heart: every human heart or every human being seeks happiness. It's just true. This is without exception. Whatever different means we employ, we tend always to this end. I think every human being seeks happiness. What do you think so far? I think so. It is the cause of some going to war and others avoiding it. Isn't that interesting? It is the same desire in both, attended in different views. Our will never takes the least step but to this object. And that's what I want to talk about today. This is the motive of every action of every person. Seeking one's own happiness, I think God wants to speak to us from this place today. Seeking one's own happiness is not a sin. It is a simple given in human nature. I can bear witness to that. You know, even to the greatest, forgive the analogy, but I must use it, to the greatest extreme. We were watching the movie Luther again last night. And in the movie Luther, there was a young boy who took his own life. He hung himself. But I must say, even in that act or that action, he was still looking for a happiness. Because we're looking to get away from our pain, get away from our sorrow. We're looking to ease ourselves of our discomfort and our sorrow in this life. Amen. And I believe it's the law of the human heart to always seek happiness. And I think God really wants us to understand and to know that it is not a sin to seek your happiness. I believe it's built inside of us. I love how it's built inside our documents. You know, it is life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Amen, everybody. Amen. I think sometimes as Christians we need to relook at that, because I think at times we think our Christian duty is otherwise. So seeking one's own happiness, it is the law of the human heart. So in regard to our conversation today, if the question is asked to the church today, let's see, if we were to ask the church the question today, what they thought as the highest Christian virtue, what is the highest Christian virtue? I would say that some of us, if not most of us, I know how I would answer that question. Usually I say the highest Christian virtue is selflessness. And I love selflessness. I think it's a rare virtue, quite honestly. Because by and large, in the time that we're living, I think, unfortunately, I think we have a tendency to selfishness. And if you've ever experienced a selfless act, it's quite beautiful, amen? Maybe it was issued towards you, or maybe you see someone else in a selfless act. I think it's one of the greatest virtues. I think before our conversation today, I would have listed it as the greatest virtue, to be selfless. To be selfless. However, I must say, in regard to that, I would like to quote Jesus. Really, let's turn to another passage. Let's turn to Matthew, and let's turn to the 16th chapter in Matthew. And in this passage here, it seems to be a passage that I have lived by, and I think some of you have lived by too. I wanna talk to you about this today, quite honestly. So in Matthew 16, verse 24, we'll start with 24, it says here that, then Jesus said to his disciples, okay, let's read this together. Jesus said to his disciples, if anyone desires to come after me, what does it say? Let him deny himself. It's the act of selflessness. Let him deny himself. Let him take up his cross and follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake shall find it. For what profit is it if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? Or what will a man give in exchange for his soul? Right? For the Son of Man will come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and then he will reward each according to his works. Assuredly I say to you, there are some standing here who shall not taste death till they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. Once again, the word of the Lord. I have always been intrigued by this passage. Many of you know this passage. Some of you live by this passage. Amen. I love the wording of it. It says, if anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself. Let him deny himself. And I would say, now the New Testament, I would say, has lots to say about self-denial. I would say the Christian faith has lots to say about self-denial. But self-denial is not an end in itself. There is a purpose for self-denial. Self-denial is just not for the purpose of us having without, of us living a sacrificial life, of us living a life unto God. Therefore, there is no pleasure or desire mixed with that. I would say self-denial is not an end in itself. We are told to deny ourselves. We're told to take up our crosses in order that we may follow Christ. As if to desire our own good and earnestly hope for enjoyment is a bad thing. Now, I don't know who I'm speaking for. I know I'm speaking for myself for sure. Maybe some of you have been tempted to think this way. But in my pursuit of God and my absolute love for Him, I would find it no consideration. I will deny myself for the cause of Christ. I love how God asks us to deny ourselves. I love how God asks us to think of others and so on. But there must be an understanding that to deny yourself is not an end in itself. There must be a reason why we deny ourselves, and there must be a reward attached to it. There must be a reward attached to self-denial. To live a life of just self-denial is a miserable life. Has anybody tried? And I'm going to speak for myself, and I think I'm speaking for some of you as well. I have no problem sometimes doing my Christian duty. I'll do what God wants me to do. I'll do what I'm told to do, and at the end of the day, I'll say, Lord, how'd we do today? I'll lay my head down, I'll go to sleep, and wake up and do it again. I'm not looking for necessarily joy or pleasure. I'm just looking to please the Father. However, I'm beginning to rethink that's a wrong understanding of the call of God upon our lives. I believe in what I'm speaking about today. I believe in the law of the human heart, where every human heart, every human being seeks happiness. And to live a life of self-denial cannot be a means to an end. There must be a purpose for it. There must be a reward attached to it. There must be a happiness attached to that. There must be a promise attached to that. Amen? I mean, isn't our Lord, isn't our God, isn't our God about promises? About seeking Him and finding Him. If you look for Him, you shall find Him. Doesn't the scriptures tell us, doesn't Christianity teach us that He is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him? But so many times we're just wrapped up and we get caught up where it's like, oh, I don't need no reward. I just do this for the glory of God. But we don't know what the glory of God is, quite honestly. Have you ever said something like that? I don't need anything in return. This is for the glory of God. But really the truth is we all need something in return. We need some kind of a happiness attached to what we do. We need some kind of a fulfillment, some kind of a longing inside of us that is fulfilled. Even if I want nothing monetary from you, if I don't want you to pay me back what I've given to you, I still want something from you. And what I want from you, if I give you something, what I want is I want you to enjoy it. I want you to be happy, and then I want you to benefit in your happiness. Amen, everybody.
Amen.
So I'm beginning to understand Scripture in a different way, quite honestly. Because the law of the human heart is we all seek happiness. And even in our service to God, I know we're not looking for monetary things, the silliness that we preach sometimes. But there is something that I want in return for my service to God. And I say it is not a sin to want happiness. It is not a sin to want reward. It is not a sin to want pleasure and delight. But I say that our pleasure and my delight is found in the happiness of others then, those who have benefited from our sacrifice. Amen. And should that not be? And don't you find that, you know, I mean, your heart will speak to you. Don't you find that to be true? Like when you do something for someone to go out of your way, you at least want that person to benefit in some way. You want that person to be happy, fulfilled. You know, I mean, aren't you overjoyed when you give something to someone and they just react in such a great way? Like, oh my God, I never expected such a wonderful thing. I mean, that's reward enough, ain't it? You know? And I want us to understand our Christian faith better. Because sometimes we think it's our ardent Christian duty to live a life of self-denial and expect nothing in return. But I say that is not true. I say that there is the law of the human heart where we all seek happiness. I think that we want something in return and we're promised. I want you to know that you're promised something in return. And the promise is for you to experience someone else's happiness, someone else's freedom. The reward of what you have sacrificially given to someone, you know, you have sacrificed in your life and you have sacrificially given to people. You want a reward. And you know, the people that I look out to bless, and I'm sure you the same, you want them to be overwhelmed with joy. You want them to be overwhelmed with peace. I'm sure some of you wish you could take away all their troubles, right? And keep on doing what you do. But I want us to see that there is still a reward promised to us. I still want us to see that self-denial in and of itself, will leave you wanting. And I think we need to hear this word, otherwise we're going to live a miserable Christian life. we're going to do our duty and be happy with nothing and be happy with no one at the end of the day. Has anyone lived a day like that? If not a life like that, we will do what God wants us to do. It's my honor to do what he's called us to do and expect nothing in return. But the truth of the matter is, I'll tell you, man, after a while, listen, I want something in return. I want something back. And we're promised it. And I think we should look for it. I think we should want it. I think we should want to benefit the world. We should want to change people's lives. We should want to put smiles on people's faces. We should want to make people happy. I think that is our benefit. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And it brings happiness and enjoyment back into life again. And I think God wants to do something about that, quite honestly. So today I submit to you that the virtue of self-denial is an end in itself without the promise of desire and pleasure. This thinking that you can have no pleasure or you can have no benefit, it has no part of the Christian faith. I believe that this pick up my cross and follow him as if you get no reward for that is a fallacy. There is reward. I believe that the passage itself even speaks of a reward. If not, it says it right there in verse 27. It says, "For the Son of Man shall come in all of his glory, shall come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and then he will reward each according to his works." I mean, even in that one passage where we set our lives to a life of selflessness, a life of sacrifice, a life of denying ourselves, even in that one passage, I cannot tell you that I really have overlooked that part where there is promise of reward. Otherwise, you cannot sustain that kind of a life. Amen. It's not a pleasurable life. And I think what that does is causes us to live a life of self-denial, constantly beating ourselves down, and it's not sustainable. You will wreck. You will absolutely wreck. You will come to an end because it comes against the law of nature, actually comes against the law of the human heart. So once again, in our teaching today, I want us to see the law of the human heart, and I want us to see that seeking one's happiness, it is not a sin. And I think we should, and we are encouraged to seek our happiness in this life, to look for desire, to enjoy desire and passion, and know that it is a part of the Christian life. So let's take a look once again at Matthew 22. I want to re-look at Matthew 22. So why don't you turn there again, or Brother Keith has us. Matthew 22, the greatest commandment of all. Let us look at the greatest commandment according to Jesus Christ. What is the greatest commandment? To love God and to love each other. So I would say that love is the greatest virtue in humanity. I used to think that selflessness and self-denial was a wonderful virtue. I no longer think so. I know when it's not attached to reward and benefit and happiness. I think the greater of the virtues is love. And I think Jesus affirms that. When they asked Jesus, what is the greatest commandment? He didn't say to deny yourself, right? He didn't say to pick up your cross and follow him. That's not what he said. Isn't it amazing what Jesus said? When Jesus said the greatest commandment, it is not self-denial. It is love. Actually, it's an invitation to enter into desire, to enter into passion, to enter into happiness, to enter into delight. It's just the opposite. Amen. Because I once again, I submit to you, self-denial by itself is not a Christian act. Self-denial has to be attached to reward. It has to be attached to benefit. It has to be attached to desire. Otherwise, there's no power. You know what self-denial turns into? Then without the benefit of happiness, it turns into pride. It turns into to pride in your sacrifice, like no one lives as holy as you. You live a nice sacrificial life, and you get no recognition and no thanks for it. It's not. Can you see that? It's a life of pride. It's a life of arrogance. It's a life of condemning others. It comes against the heart of the matter. I find that fascinating. Therefore, I would say the greatest of the virtues, I would have to line up with Jesus Christ now and say the greatest of the virtues is not self-denial, but the greatest of the virtues is love. Amen. It is absolutely love. Love is the greatest virtue in humanity, not selflessness. And there is a great difference between love and selflessness. There's a great difference. When Christ says that love is greater than the virtue of selflessness, selflessness here, it's a negative term that has been replaced for a positive. You know, this makes the big difference in the way we live, because a negative meaning of selflessness is not primary. The primary is not to secure someone else's happiness. Selflessness is just for me to do without. The primary definition of selflessness is me to do without. Me to do without what? Whatever. I'll lose my life. That means I'll lose all the joy and all the desires in this life. It's not attached to anything else. And therefore, I must say, selflessness without a benefit, without a reward, without a desire to benefit others, it's nothing but empty. It's nothing but angry. It's nothing but harsh. So the negative term, I tell you what, it needs to be turned into a positive. So selflessness, I say the greatest virtue is love, because selflessness is just a matter of us doing without. Selflessness is just you living a life of abstinence and not desiring happiness for anyone else. Has anyone been raised in the church where you've been taught just to live without, but nothing really to replace it, you know? Is there anybody in the house besides me, for crying out loud? I was told when I was raised to live without, but nothing in return. How can you give me nothing in return? As a young man or as a young woman or any human being, how can you ask for sacrifice and self-denial with no reward and with no benefit? How can we ask each other, how can we think that God is asking us to live a life of denial, to deny myself of any pleasure that this world would call pleasure? God forbid you should have pleasure in this life. God forbid you should laugh or dance or sing or whatever brings merriment to the heart. God forbid your heart be merry. God forbid. Well, what on earth are we supposed to do then? What do you expect us to do? What do we expect the young to do? What did Christianity expect me to do and you to do as a young man or a young woman? What did Christianity expect us to do? I'll tell you what happens. You get bitter. You get jaded. You get tired. You become self-righteous. And you condemn the world around you. Yeah. Because it's not sustainable. Because the law of the human heart is to seek happiness. You cannot rid the human heart of your pursuit of happiness. But in our Christianity, we didn't understand it. Therefore, we would preach, if anyone would find their life, let them lose it. Let them deny themselves. And the New Testament has many teachings of self-denial, but it's not whole without the purpose of self-denial. Self-denial is just not a life of abstinence. And I know we preach abstinence, abstinence, abstinence. Well, what do you put in its place then? Then what do you put in its place? If I can't do anything, what the heck do I mean? Am I speaking with anybody? What do you do for fun? What do you do for pleasure? Well, I read the Bible, of course. Well, I go to church. I read the Bible. I witness. And I think God wants to give us clarity of mind and understanding. When the young man, the lawyer, asked Jesus, what is the greatest commandment? He did not say self-denial. He said love is. And love is an invitation into desire, passion, joy, happiness with God and with each other. He says, the commandment itself is an oxymoron. Like, how do you command love? Right? Like that statement of Christ, the greatest commandment is love. It's an oxymoron. Love can't be commanded. Love is kind of just, I don't know, it just flows. It's initiated. It's prompted, right? It's birthed. It's not commanded. You know, you can't command a husband to love a wife. Two strangers come together. You will love her and she will love you and you will be married and you will be happy. I mean, love, and now, you know, isn't it interesting that God says the greatest commandment is love? Because, you know, God is saying something to us here. I know that God is saying something. I love that the greatest virtue, according to Jesus Christ, it is not self-denial, everybody. And I think God wants us to understand these things. I love that it's an invitation into life itself. I mean, if you could just consider that one passage today or however long, that the greatest commandment is love. It's to love God. It's to enjoy God. It's to love life. It's to love someone else. It's to love a person, to enter into a life and enjoy life with someone. Isn't that amazing that that's the commandment of God? To go enjoy life with somebody, to experience passion, to experience emotion, to experience desire. That's the commandment of God. Amen. Amen. Because the law of the human heart is, and you know this to be true, we all seek happiness. And we're supposed to. And we're commanded throughout Scripture to seek happiness. Do you know that? We're not to deny happiness. It's unsustainable. It's not human. It's not human to live a life without the pursuit of happiness. God doesn't say pursue duty, everybody. He does not say pursue duty. You know that God does not want you to spend your life pursuing duty and your service to God. No, that should not be anybody's life. Do you know that? Maybe you need to think about it. The commandment of God was not to serve him. The commandment of God was to love him, to enjoy him. Not to go and beat yourself and wear yourself out and do all your duty and at the end of the day go to bed tired and without reward. God gave us a life. He gave us a life to enjoy. We don't know how to enjoy it. We're conflicted. We're so darn conflicted, I would say. We tell each other to deny ourselves, to deny ourselves, to deny ourselves. The only reason why God would ever tell you to deny yourself is for a greater pleasure. He says, I want you to deny yourself the lesser pleasure because I want to give you a greater pleasure. Yeah, absolutely be joyful there. And it's not to be without pleasure. It's to give us greater pleasure. And I think God wants to give that to us, quite honestly. Let me see here. Matthew 22. Okay. Well then let's look at Matthew 16 again in regard to carrying your cross. Let's take a look at that again. So in Matthew 16, it says, okay, I found this interesting. This kind of lit up for me. Because I said, there's got to be something here I'm missing. You know, I just said that the other day. I said, I've got to be missing something in this passage. I think I'm missing something. How many times have you read this passage? I said, I think I'm missing something here. So Jesus said to his disciples, if anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself, deny himself, deny himself. But look at what's prior to deny himself. Desire. So the greatest aspect of this verse is not denial, it's desire. God wants us to pursue desire, not denial. Do you find that fascinating? I do. Because it changes my theology entirely, it changes my philosophy of life. My theology is my belief in the systems of God. My philosophy is my beliefs in the systems of life. It changes them both. And now I look at this verse of self-denial, of picking up your cross, because some of us think, oh, I can do it better than anyone else. Anyone in the house? I know some of you. Like, I can do it better than anyone else. I could turn it off. I can be indifferent in this life. I could not care about a darn thing my whole life and go to my dying day. It's okay. If that's what you want, Lord, fine. Like, you're kind of giving up on it. Is there any out of soul in the house that wants to give me out of a gentle whisper? Amen, Lord. It's like, I'll do that, Lord. I'll do that. But then I've missed the Christian faith entirely. I've missed it entirely. I've missed life entirely. Because the purpose of life, of God giving us life and breath, I know you can all become weary and jaded in this life, but the reason why God gave you life is for joy and pleasure, for laughter, for desire. Why do you think you have that flesh? It's for desire, it's for pleasure. Amen, everybody. Amen. And we don't understand it, and therefore we say, deny it, deny it, deny it. Yeah, but look at the first part of the verse. I just saw that, really. It just opened up to me. The verse doesn't start with denial. It says, if anyone has desire. Well, gee, that's me. The law of the human heart is everyone seeks happiness. It's right there. If anyone has desire, God says, if you have desire, I'm going to show you how to shape your desire. I'm going to tell you what to do with your desire. Because sometimes you do have to shape your desires, right? You do have to guide them to enjoy them fully, right? Because we all have desires in our lives. Some of our desires, you know, bring us to hard times, right? But some of our desires are just pure and beautiful. And I think God wants to help guide our desires also, not eliminate them. Sometimes when we don't understand God and life, we don't understand life, we eliminate them. it's that abstinence thing. Like, you know, sometimes you don't know, like, we all want the rule book, everybody. Everybody wants the rule book. That's why we want the Bible. Just give me a rule book. Tell me the rules and I'll live by them. Here's the Ten Commandments. That's all. Just tell me what to do and I'll do it. Because we don't trust our human hearts. We don't know how to live. We don't know how to negotiate life. And therefore, sometimes we say, is it good? Sometimes some of us are better off with abstinence rather than just, like if you're hungry at night, just take out like a little bit of Jell-O and a little bit of whipped cream. That's all. It just satisfies. Like, I don't know. Listen, I will rather practice abstinence than have a little bit of Jell-O. Because I can't have a little bit of Jell-O. But some of us are not good with that. Some of us, is like, it's just, I don't know. What are the rules, man? Like, how much can I have, you know? So to avoid getting in trouble, it's like, I won't have anything. And we think we're doing better than most. No, you're not. You have just denied yourself of the basic fundamental of life itself, which is to enjoy life. Now, I might be speaking to some of you now who might like to go home and have a little Jell-O with a little whipped cream. And I know putting that thought in your head, I've lost you entirely. So now you're going to think about, oh, I can have that cake. See, the problem is we eat the whole cake and not just the piece of cake. You know, let me tell you something. You know, we have a problem eating the whole cake. Therefore, we say, you know, get rid of the cake. Darn it, throw it in the garbage. Like, don't throw it. That's a delicious cake. Do not throw that in the garbage. Can't you just have a piece of the cake? You know, but I want to draw pictures. I want to bring us somewhere. I want us to say that the Christian faith is not abstinence. I want you to hear that it is not abstinence. It is not denial in an end of itself. That is not the Christian faith. Some of us think that. I have thought that. It's just denial. Do not know it isn't. It's not the gospel by any means. It is not our God. It is not life. Inside our nature is the pursuit of happiness. You need pleasure in this life, and you cannot live without it. You are destitute without pleasure. And I love when I go back and I revisit Matthew 16. It doesn't start off with me denying myself, but I live there. But it starts off with desire. How about that? Well, that is so true. My human heart says it's true. Doesn't your human heart say it's true? I start off with desire. And look at the desire. I want us to somehow, you know, understand it also. You know, it says, if anyone desires to come after me, you know, our greatest desire, everybody? Our greatest desire should be God. If anyone desires what? Desires God. And we're free to desire him. Because we think desiring God means you have to cut off your humanity. You can no longer experience your humanity. And that's we don't understand that yet. We don't understand the paradox that Jesus spoke. And Jesus always spoke in paradoxes. You ask him the greatest command. He says, the greatest command is this. You ready for the greatest command? It wasn't to do your Christian duty, everybody. It wasn't to go to church. It wasn't to give your offerings. What is the greatest commandment? It's love. Really? What an invitation. The greatest commandment is love. It's to love, to enjoy, to experience, to desire. We've gotten to a place where, like, he has to command us to it. Like, gosh darn it, you're going to have fun today. If it kills you, you're going to have fun today. You're going to enjoy it. If it's the last thing you do, you're going to enjoy this. And I think we need to see God in a different light. I think God wants to understand our humanity. I think sometimes we spend, let me talk to you just for a second, you know, just bring some new awarenesses. Maybe you start to think different, you know, this life that God gave to us, my goodness, like, why do you think he gave it to you? So you can deny it and go to heaven? Really? Like, isn't there purpose to this life? We all think the purpose of this life is to die and go to heaven. No, it isn't. No, it isn't. Like, our main purpose in life is to get everybody saved. Well, I mean, salvation is just another word for salvation is really it's freedom, it's happiness, it's love, it's joy, it's peace. I mean, that's our object in this life. And it's not about duty. It's not about service. Jesus did not say the greatest command was duty or service. He said it was love. It was joy. Enjoy the life. And we don't know how to enjoy the life, so we abstain instead. We choose abstinence instead. God didn't say abstinence from this life. He did not say that. He said, if you have a great desire, he says, if you really want to fulfill desire and you really want to enjoy this life, I'm going to show you how to do it. He said, let him deny himself. And I think it's an incorporation. It's finding happiness, not in your own selfish pursuit, but in the pursuit of the happiness of others. It's to look for the benefit of those around you. It's my God, it's for you to enjoy the people around you. I think a lot of us don't even enjoy the people around us, quite honestly. We can barely stand ourselves, never mind the people around us. How about that? I mean, sometimes what you preached last week, Pastor Phil, and I didn't get it until afterwards, but you told me we need to see the good and the wonderful in each other, not the bad and the ugly. But when I see the bad and the ugly in each other, I'm so sure not enjoying you. But there's a choice to be made. There's eyes to be given to us. Let us see the good things in people and enjoy it. Enjoy it. Amen. And enjoy the good things of each other. Laugh with each other. Embrace each other. Don't cut each other down. Rather live life with each other. The greatest commandment is to love God and love who else? Your neighbor. It's to enter into a passion, a desire, a fulfillment, a love, a happiness with those around you. You know, and God knows very well, he's got to command it of you. Once again, he says, I'm going to command you. If I have to command you, you will enjoy everybody around you. Gosh darn it, Bill. He says, we're going to enjoy everybody around us. You're going to enjoy your neighbors. You're going to enjoy your family. You're going to enjoy people. You're going to love life. Isn't that fascinating? To me, it's fascinating. It changes in my mind, in my theology, the greatest virtue. For I no longer believe the greatest virtue is such a miss. It's such a miss to think that the greatest virtue is selflessness. It is not. The greatest virtue is love. And when we're told to deny ourselves, it doesn't start off by saying deny yourselves. It starts off by saying to desire something greater. To desire something. If you have desire, I will show you how to fulfill your desire, not get rid of it. Amen. Amen. Now let God take you where he needs to take you with that. But God says, I'm going to tell you how to fulfill your desire. He says, if you have desire, he doesn't say get rid of your desire. He says, let me show you how to fulfill your desire. And fulfill the law of the human heart, which is to seek and pursue happiness, everybody. Amen. Amen. Yes. Yes, amen. Praise God. So therefore, the most important part of the verse, it's to desire God. Have you ever desired God? I don't know if you have desired God. I would say that today is also an invitation for you all to desire God. And I give you that invitation to desire God. Have you ever had any time of your life where you did desire God? And you just wanted to be with him. You loved him. You know that he was good to you. And there was no one greater on earth to be with than God. Right? Have you ever had a question asked to you, like, what do you want in this life? And maybe the answer was, well, I just want more of God. I desire God. When God asked Solomon what he wanted, what if God appeared to you at the night and said, what do you want? Like, what do you want? You want money? Nonsense. Nonsense. What do you want? You want money? You want cars? You want houses? You want jobs? What do you want? And maybe you could answer God, I just want you, Lord. I want you. Will you reveal yourself to me? Will you live this life with me? May I enter into the joy of the Lord? And that's not talking about you dying. May I enter into the joy of the Lord in this life? I pray that you enter into the joy of the Lord in this life, that you realize why you're upon this earth. It's for pleasure. It's for the pursuit of happiness. Why did God make you? He created you for pleasure. For pleasure. He wasn't looking to put you to work. What are we, slaves? What are we, slaves in Egypt? He created you for his good pleasure. To enjoy life and to enjoy life with him. And we all went to work. My goodness, sometimes I'm looking for where the church is. I think, well, the whole church went to work. Nobody has a desire for God, but we sure will go to work. Whatever that is, you know. I'm not just talking about your jobs. I'm just talking about you going to work. Well, how about just taking a minute and loving the Lord your God and loving your neighbor as yourself? When God says that's the greatest commandment, to enjoy the pleasure that he created you for. Amen, everybody. I think we need to reconsider. I think God has a gift for us today. I say to you this, I say it to myself, but I also say it to you. I say, why don't you desire God? Desire Him. Want Him. And it's not at the expense of saying no to the people around you. You understand that? Because some of you think that's the hermit lifestyle. That's the monk lifestyle. Just me and God and nobody else. That's not what it's saying. Because the second is also likened unto the first. It's to love your neighbor. You cannot have desire and pleasure in God without sharing it with somebody else in this life. Amen. It's not possible. The only way you will fully enjoy the fellowship with God is to enjoy it with a person. Amen. Because God is invisible. Have you figured that one out? God is invisible. You can't physically hug Him. You can't physically touch Him. You can't physically talk to Him and cry with Him and laugh with Him. He's invisible. Have you discovered that? But He made Himself visible in a person. And then He says, there you go. And there you go. And may that be your desire, everybody. Amen. So therefore, the first part, I want us to let that be burned and etched within our souls and our spirits, that this passage about denying oneself, it starts off with absolute desire. If anyone has desire, let him deny himself, right? Deny himself. It means embracing everybody. It's not just about you. It means to embrace others, to embrace God, and to embrace others, and then to enjoy this life and actually fulfill. You told me at the beginning of our conversation tonight, the greatest commandment is to love God and to love each other. It's to enter into desire and passion and happiness and the pursuit thereof. Amen, everybody. Amen. So in closing, I want us to understand this. May God give you new life and new understanding in this. I pray. We are not to suppress our desires or our pursuit of happiness, but rather have them all fulfilled. Have them all fulfilled in Him for sure. You know that, in Him. But we are not to suppress our desires, our passions, our pursuit of, but have them fulfilled in Him. The commandment to love, like I said, it's a contradiction of terms. But if you need a commandment, because some of you at this point, you need to start off with a commandment. So let us be, I would say, let us be as the young lawyers today. Let us be the scribe. Let us be the one who approaches God and say, Lord, what is the great commandment? Tell me the great commandment and I shall fulfill it. As if God was going to give you a duty to fulfill, a task to accomplish. Like, go cut the lawn, or go, clean the windows, or go. No. What is the greatest command that I may fulfill it? And I pray that we are as the lawyer that approaches Jesus this day, and we say, I say that you ask for the first time, perhaps, or ask anew. I pray that you ask anew for those of you who have asked before, and say, Lord, what is the greatest commandment? And may you hear the voice of God and the voice of Jesus Christ speak to you and say, my commandment to you is this. Are you ready, everybody? Are you ready? I'm asking you. Are you ready? He says, I command you to love. I command you to enjoy this life. I command you to enjoy your life. I command you to have desire. I command you to have passion. I command you to pursue happiness. I command you to find it in Him and each other. This is the commandment of God. Well, some of us need that. Because unless God tells me to do it, I ain't going to do it. But that is the command to you today. Amen, everybody. May you enjoy the blessing of the Lord. May it be renewed in your heart. And may you live a life of, I would say, as God designed, a life of true happiness. Amen. God bless you all. I'll ask our praise and worship team to come on forward. Why don't we all stand? All right, you're welcome. God bless you.
Amen. Thank you, worship team. Well, thank you for that, brother. You know, I pray God will continue to unpack that word this week. I don't know that we have it all. We never have it all, amen. But I believe it's God's word that, will reveal things. And then it's also His word that does the work, right? I believe it's Philippians says that it's God who works in us, both to will and to do, both to desire and to live. According to what? Well, it says his good pleasure. Didn't say his good misery. And so I believe God will work in us. I believe his word will work in us. And I pray that you continue to seek God this week and let him reveal that. And let him continue to show you. And I know I am. And say, you know, it's okay, yeah. And we are just as Isaac, the children of promise. What was Isaac? It was joy. The son he gave, it was joy. That's what he's saying. And so I believe that to be true, and I believe God will continue to reveal that. And I pray that God will allow us to desire once again and then fulfill him, because he's a God of promise. Amen. Let's go before the Lord. Heavenly Father, we're grateful for the word this morning, Lord God. And we're grateful for your revelation, Lord, for the time that you have given us now, Lord. And we pray, Lord God, that you would grant us new desires, Lord God, that you would birth them in our heart, Lord God, and then we would trust you to fulfill them, Lord God, that we would be filled with your joy and your gladness, Lord, because it is your good pleasure. It is your good pleasure that you've given your children, Lord God, and we are grateful for that, Lord. So, Lord, we thank you for the day, for this house, for all that you are doing. We pray your blessings on each and every one. In Jesus' name, amen.